So I'm really excited today to introduce three great speakers for the third episode of this virtual series called the NS Virtual Roundtable, Keeping Innovation Alive. And you know, I'd like to do a little round robin here and introduce each of our speakers, starting with Ram. Ram, would you like to introduce yourself? Give us a couple minutes.
Absolutely. Thanks for the opportunity, Bill, to partake in this panel discussion, to share some life experiences and some perspectives on this very broad topic on innovation. Just as an introduction, I'm Ramnath Ramkrishnan. I go by Ram. I'm the Chief Technology Officer for Eaton Corporation. I've been in the engineering technology innovation world for 30 plus years. And by training, by my passion, my heart, I'm a blacksmith. I'm a blacksmith by training. I'm a blacksmith by practitioner. 10 years, I did forgings for aircraft engines. That was my job.
Whoa.
Yeah. And so that's still in my heart, blacksmithy. I love it. And in the last 15 years, I've been working for this company, Eaton, 8 years as a CTO, really focusing on technology, engineering, innovation, primarily focusing on power management, how the world produces, consumes electrons or electricity, and how the world around us, around mobility and all the different segments, is really changing. And so Eaton, we are kind of not only are participating in these innovations and these new areas, but also hopefully writing a few chapters to say what is the future of energy trends is going to be for the world we live in. So that's a little bit about myself.
That's fantastic. Thanks so much for participating. We're honored to have you here. And Leslie, you're next.
Yeah, hi. I'm Leslie Shannon. I'm Nokia's head of ecosystem and trend scouting. I'm located out here in Silicon Valley. And Nokia as a company, we've got one of the worst brand problems in the world because everybody pretty much still associates us with the product that we don't make anymore. So we used to have a mobile handset business and we sold the phone business to Microsoft back in 2014. And so But our company, you know, we've got 100,000 people globally. And what we do is what we have always done that was never as well known as the phone business is we build the network equipment for the mobile phone networks and for fixed line as well. So we're a business to business company and our main customers are the phone companies of the world. But my job, particularly looking at innovations, I'm specifically looking at innovations that are coming from industries outside of telecommunications. And the reason for the development of my job actually came from our experience with the whole mobile phone debacle. And I've been with the company 20 years, so I was there for the rise and the fall of that side of the company. I've always been on the network side myself. You know, part of the reason that we lost the mobile phone business was that we only focused on the telecommunications world, and we weren't looking at what was going on in the rest of the world. And the company that came and did the most damage to us and our market share came from the computer world. Apple was a computer company then, and we didn't take it seriously because it was outside of our orbit. And so my role now is specifically to look at things outside the telecommunications industry and understand the wide swath of what's coming so that we can actually both make sure that we're not going to get, you know, blindsided again, and also to look for opportunities. What is coming that we're going to need to build the networks for? And then I share that with our customers and hopefully with some of the people listening today.
Thank you for joining. And last but not least, Randy.
Last but not least, thanks. I appreciate that, Bill.
No, seriously though, Randy, I want to say, first of all, I'm really happy for you to be here. You know, Randy is a very active member of the CTA and that's where I met you. And, you know, honestly, it's just awesome to have you here.
Oh, well, I guess that's my introduction. I like that. I'm Randy Kellogg. I'm CEO of Omron Healthcare. I run the Americas, lead the Americas, I should say. My team runs it. I just kind of hold on to the reins while they do all the work. But Omron Healthcare is part of Omron Corporation, which is a big Japanese company. We're into all sorts of other things, robotics, components, safety, environmental, all sorts of things. But my business focuses on healthcare. Our mission, or our vision as we call it, is to eliminate heart attack and stroke. We call it going for zero. We're working really hard to make sure that people manage their heart health on their own and with the guidance of their physician. And that's what we've been doing. We've been trying to do the best job possible, especially through the pandemic period, because it's very likely if you have a heart condition, you are more susceptible to the disease if you get it. So we want to make sure people understand what their heart health is, get the right treatment, take care of themselves. And that's us. I've been doing it for 15 years with Omron. I have about 32 years in the medical industry. So I've always been in medical. It's always been my passion to try to help people. And with the last 15 years, it's been great because really helping people take care of their hearts is a big thing.
Thank you so much for joining. You know, let's get started. You know, each of you has such impressive careers in business, technology, and innovation. If you had to switch careers today into a completely different field, what would you do instead? Why? Maybe you want to start with Ram. You know, it might be a little applicable to you.
I spent my entire life around STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, really. I've been a professional engineer, technologist, innovation, business partner. But to be honest with you, all that for me is a means to an end. And the end actually is a cook. I want to be a cook, and it's still not too late for me, by the way. So I love food. I love the ingredients. I love food from all over. If, as I rewrite some of my chapters as we move forward, there's something that I would definitely do around food, just because of the creativity that you bring about when you're cooking. And then the best part is feeding others and the reaction. There will be something around food. So I'm glad that I spent 30 years doing what I did, because it now gives me the opportunity to do really what I want to do, which is be around food.
that sounds great, you know. And I guess you're local. I'll look forward to my invite. Leslie, how could you top that?
I come from 1 foot in the tech world and 1 foot in the art world. Actually, my undergraduate degree was in neuroanatomy, and my graduate degree was in history of art. So I've always had my career kind of looking at both sides. And the place that I am most excited about right now is the whole world of the spatial internet or the metaverse or the world that happens when you put on augmented reality glasses and go out into the world and have the information or entertainment value of the internet actually integrated with the world around you. That's one of the most exciting things that I'm seeing being created right now in the technology that I'm scoping. And it's really the kind of thing that you tell people about it now and people are like, oh my God, are you kidding me? That sounds completely science fiction. Really clunky if I see examples of it today, but I tell you, I've been watching the TV series *Halt and Catch Fire*. Recently, I've been binging that, and that's about the early PC clone days in the early 80s. And it's fiction, but it's kind of retelling that. And seeing the screens, the computer screens back in 1983, and that's when I got my first PC. And just what they were like, and the vision that people had then. And of course, they're describing things that we are completely take for granted today. And they sound crazy and completely nutso when they're talking about it in 1983. But that's where we are with this whole world of mixed reality, the stuff that people are talking about. These are the visions that are actually going to shape the world that we're going to be living in 10 to 20 years from now. So if I were starting over right now, that is, I'm in it now. But if I were like 20, I would totally be in it.
You're already in the box.
Wave that's going to go much further than my career is going to go. Yeah.
It's funny. I'll give a little shout out to Innovation Leader. I met you during an Innovation Leader event, which we're members of, called Charting the Future of Corporate Growth. And you inspired me to start reading Ready Player Now. So thanks a lot.
Good, Randy, enjoy it.
Randy, what are your thoughts? What are your interests lying in?
Well, Bill, you know what I want to be, right? I'd want to own the Cleveland Indians. But since that's probably outside of my financial well-being, I'd probably go to some other passion that I have. Which would be wine. I could hook up with Ram and do the wine for his restaurant while he's cooking. I love wine. I have for 30 odd years. And I would want to do something with wine, whether it would be a wine store or maybe work in a tasting room out in Napa Valley, something where I could help people learn about wine, help them understand how wine accents foods, what wine to drink it, how to just enjoy it, because some people think it's really a mystery, and it's not that much of a mystery. You know, if you find something you like, stick with it and drink it. I would be something about wine.
So this is, selfishly, I just got three really good tips. I'm going to have dinner at Rahm's. I'm going to watch Holton catch fire. And I'm going to ask Randy about what wine to get.
There you go.
You're all set. Yeah.
You're done, well, Bill. Yeah. That's good.
I was just thinking I could create the augmented reality menus for your restaurant. Yes. Because this is...
we're all tied together, you know. I really think this is a great segue into into this question, you know, as we're all here for. You know, we all have our own lives, you know, we all have our own jobs, you know. So, you know, as that kind of intertwines and works today, what kind of things should corporate innovators be focused on right now?
If I may,
Leslie.
Yeah, listening to your customers, because your customers' needs today are not the same as they were 6 months ago, and our industry has actually been quite upended. You know, this was going to be for us the year of 5G, and 5G rollouts are still going on. Except what's happening is with all the school kids of the entire world suddenly at home and all the workers of the whole world entirely at home, what's happened is that suddenly all the countries of the world have discovered the gaps that they have in their basic networks, you know, their fixed line networks and fiber. And so we're getting, you know, massive orders for fixed line and fiber that we did not intend. And so we've had to kind of rethink, like, okay, yeah, we still want to put some attention on 5G, but we've got to be filling the gaps here, because that's what our customers need, because our customers are suddenly discovering these new things that they didn't have. And you know, if that's happening in our industry, I can only imagine it's happening, people going back to the basics and rediscovering the gaps that were not filled in the previous work, and then realizing they got to do that.
Well, and we're putting a lot of pressure on everything. I mean, everybody's at home, you know, fighting with the kids on Netflix versus your meeting. So it's going to be a struggle. You know, Randy, what do you think about this?
Well, I'll look at it from the medical side, because that's where I live every day. And yeah. We have to be able to deliver healthcare in a much different manner than we've ever delivered it before. Before the pandemic, everybody talked about telehealth. You know, being able to pick up your phone or on your computer, talk to your clinician, your healthcare provider, whoever it might be. But very few people did it. Probably 20% of people ever did it. And in a matter of a few months, we've jumped to 40 or 50% of people are having virtual visits with their physician now. And that's really important, that we don't lose track of what works for now. This new reality is probably going to work even better once we get past the pandemic and before the next pandemic, if we put it in place, support it, pay for it, set up the right focus, the right networks for it, and really help people get involved in it. Because it's not just, you know, turning on the computer and talk to your doctor. It's how do I get involved in my health so that I can share that information with my doctor. With us, it's how do I get someone to take their blood pressure? I have my cuff here on my desk. I have like four of them on my desk, actually. I take my blood pressure, I upload it, and how do I share that with my doctor? How do I get involved in my treatment so that I know that my heart health is good? So I think we should focus on learning from this crazy situation we're in, and these things that are really helping people, and how do we escalate those and do more of those in the future?
You know, I'll throw a little plug in for you. I got to get a demo last year of your watch / blood pressure cuff. And it's almost like a MacGyver or James Bond device that you don't realize you're wearing one. And it's, to be honest with you, it's wonderful, because you have the best, you know, the best tool for ongoing when you need it, you know? So healthcare is definitely a component. Rahm, you know, what are you thinking? I mean, you're talking about energy management. I mean, a lot of this stuff is sustainable. It's the new resource, right?
I mean, yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely, Bill. I think one of the big things we are focusing on, which the world in general is focusing on, is how the dynamics in the world is changing about electricity. What we mean by that is, if you really look at some of the mega trends, it's not about just generating electricity the way we have been generating and consuming, you know, centralized, you know, massive power plants and coal and oil and gas-fired power plants. But fundamentally, the shift that's happening is going to a more decentralized, more sustainable sources of electricity and electron generations, whether it's solar and wind and all of these sustainable sources. And that's fundamentally changing the nature of the grid, both in the developed parts of the world and emerging nations in the world, which fundamentally changes a lot of things around us, how we are going to move tomorrow, planes, trains, automobiles, the more electrification of everything, that fundamentally changes. And so when you compound the dynamics around electrification, plus what Randy just said about the healthcare, because that fundamental nature of healthcare is going to change, you know, the healthcare community is trying to do a few things, but two things that's really dominant is trying to keep people, patients, you, me, grandma, grandpa at home and age gracefully and be healthier in the long lives we are leading, and reducing the cost of delivering all of that healthcare is the holy grail. It's not a holy grail. This is possible, and that's exactly what companies like Randy are chasing, and what we are interested in. And what Leslie talked about is that customer focus and centricity and understanding what is needed and bringing all of these dynamics together. We rewrite the next 10, 15, 20, 30 years for the world. And I think that's the innovation challenge. If I were to add one more thing around innovation, what corporations should be focusing on, I want to bring it down kind of, Leslie had this external view, which is spot on, the customer perspective. I think if you really look at our own staff and people, what's happening as part of this COVID downtime in the last 6 months, and you just have to look at your own LinkedIn view, you know, feeds, et cetera, there are so many of our staff taking some of these micro degrees. They're getting retained, retooled, and they're taking a lot of these degrees, and they're so proud to post their little certificates they earn from a course in Coursera and Udacity. I think there's a big opportunity for corporations to tap into that energy, that excitement, and give new assignments, new projects, and involve our existing staff in different ways to kind of re-energize and make that learning productive for everybody. I think there's a huge opportunity. And finally, as a corporation, as a business leader, I'm constantly with the limited resources, especially capital we have, with our top lines being kind of, you know, under so much stress. The big focus right now is to say, what is it that we are not going to do? Not what is it that we are going to do? What is it that we are not going to do? That prioritization is becoming even more important today than it's ever been. So prioritizing what is it that we're not going to do, that everybody wants to do everything, I think is going to be amplified in the world we're living in, so that we can take the resources, you know, people, time, and money, and really place our bets in the things that really matter. So there's a few perspectives on what we are doing, we are struggling with, and we're trying to solve day in and day out.
Well, yeah, it's funny. I've heard a great quote John Spirk likes to make. Your not to-do list is probably as important or more than your to-do list, right?
Love it.
I mean, sleep is important too.
Spot on.
You know, I just want to remind everybody too that we're going to be looking at the chat window, and we'll maybe ask some of your questions here and there. So feel free to post some comments, and we'd love to have you make this an interactive. So, you know, thanks a lot for those thoughts. You know, you kind of touched on this a little bit. You know, with this COVID-19 world, it's kind of that 100-pound or 1,000-pound gorilla right now. Randy, how could corporations have been more prepared for this? I mean, what did we do wrong? I mean, I guess you necessarily can't look back, but maybe if we do, what could they have done differently, Randy?
It's hard to say what they could have done differently specifically about COVID. Mm-hmm. I think what we can do is look at what could we have done differently to be prepared for this dramatic shift in how we have to work, how we have to support our people. And that's where corporations, you know, if you're going to look back at anything now, when we do this, we look back and say, you know, did we have the right tools in place so people could work remotely? Did they have the right situation to be able to work in their home. How could we prepare ourselves better for what's going forward? Because it's not going to stop September 1st magically. This is going to go on for some time, and you know, who knows when the next pandemic will come or the next critical change will happen. But if we have people armed so that, you know, they can work where I am now sitting at my desk at home, or they can work in an office, or they can work in a Starbucks, or if they can do that very easily and get their work done efficiently, that's great. So it's not about where you work, it's about how you get the work done. And I think there's been a big shift in many companies in their thinking, because it's always about, oh, you had to be in the office. You know, I would fight with my corporate entity in Japan because they'd say, oh, having people work from home, oh, they'll never do their work. Well, believe me, they do their work. They probably work harder from home mm-hmm. than they work when they're in the office. And they have more time because there's no commute, or at mm-hmm. least they have a very short commute, like 2 minutes down the stairs. But I think corporations could have done a better job of setting themselves up for that. You know, we did what we thought was right, and it was nowhere near enough. But people have persevered and done it. But I think that's where we can really learn from this.
That's a really good point. You know, at NS here, we had established maybe a couple of years back unlimited discretionary paid time off. And it was pretty bold, you know, and it's still, it was kind of a way to show that we respected people's time as much as they respected, you know, us. And I think that to your point, you know, this whole casual nature of if he's there or if she's here or not, as long as they're doing their job. I mean, you know, it's all about trust, right? It's all about trust and yes. responsibility. You know, it's as a culture, you know, at Nokia, I got it. You know, I'm trying. So Leslie, what are your thoughts there?
Yeah, well, you know, I think trust given to employees is repaid doubly. Employees feel when they're trusted by their employer, and it helps develop loyalty and a feeling of alignment with the company that a non-trustworthy situation doesn't develop. But thinking specifically about how corporations can deal with this kind of thing and how could they have done better, I actually look at the most resilient place that I know is the city of Wellington, New Zealand, which is the capital of New Zealand. And I was actually there, actually, when the lockdown came, I was in New Zealand and I had to get myself back home. But the city council there, one of the things that they did 10 years ago was they created a digital twin of their city. And so a 3D digital map of their city that you can see on a laptop or even better in virtual reality. And they've spent the last 10 years getting all the information from all of the different city departments and scrubbing the data so it's all in the same format. That's big work. And then feeding it all into this digital twin. And what that lets them do is it lets them look at the information and the knowledge that they have about the city from all the different departments in a single format that is visual and is very clear. And they originally put this together because Wellington is a harbor city in an earthquake zone. And so that lets them run tons of what if scenarios. What if the waters rise? What if there is an earthquake? What are the buildings in the areas of the city that are going to be affected the most? And they were able to go out and do proactive shoring up of the buildings that would be affected. And actually, Wellington was hit by a worse earthquake in, I think, 2015 than Christchurch was hit with in 2011. And we didn't hear anything about it because Wellington, all the buildings didn't collapse because they had done this work ahead of time. And I just got in touch with the city council people just last week, and I said, you know, has your digital twin that you already had, has that actually enabled you to help fight COVID? And they said, absolutely. We were able to immediately partner with the phone companies and get the anonymized movement knowledge about how people are moving through the city to be able to understand when are people obeying the lockdown, and for the essential workers, where are they? And so where are the neighborhoods where there's most likely to be exposure, because these are the people who are not able to lock down, and to really put the healthcare focus on those places first. And New Zealand is one of the most successful countries in the world with fighting this. And so it's about knowledge, and it's about preparing how you can access the knowledge and be nimble with the knowledge. So when something unusual comes up, you've got ways to actually be flexible and to deal with the new situation.
You know, that's a good point. You know, I know Ram, we've always talked about, you know, your case for predictive analytics and mm-hmm. things. You know, you want to touch on some of the things that both of them have brought up?
Yeah, actually, you know, I want to pull Randy, your thread around people, right? We all talk about people, everybody. And it's true, it's a fact, right? People are the single most critical asset for all of us, right? And, you know, one of the things that we've been reflecting internally within our company is when we look at our business continuity plans, there's a list of things that we put on every year. We refresh it, you know, things like cybersecurity, things like, you know, the 100-year floodplain and where the plants are and what are we going to do about it and all those things. And I was just reflecting on that BCP, the business continuity plan. And I'm saying we have really not paid attention to exactly what Randy was talking about, is saying in a case like the world we are living in, where the mobility of the people is impacted, how do we still bring them and keep them together, keep them energized? We haven't done. And so I was thinking of saying, what else should we be doing? A couple of things, actually. I like this whole trust factor, Leslie, that you brought up, because I believe it's 100% true, because I hear even in my company from time to time in some quarters, some commentary around, are our people working from home? And I'm going, trust them. Just trust them. Leave them alone, trust them, make sure they got enough to do and leave them and they're working. So that trust is an important piece, Leslie. I completely agree with you. The other piece I was thinking of is actually, you know, most of us are global companies and regionally, if we can really do and relook, saying, are our regional teams self-sufficient, empowered to make those local calls, tap into the local supply chain and drive the growth in the best way they can, rather than coming to quote-unquote mothership, which is probably 10,000 miles away for all kinds of, you know, approvals and all those things. I think we can be much better to weather this kind of a world we're living in. And this is probably going to happen over and over again, but I think this is a nice little wake-up call, at least in the age we are living in, that many of us have witnessed this for the first time. So that whole empowerment, the regional focus, and the trusting, and then tapping into the new energy that's been created when, you know, all these folks are getting new micro degrees and all those things, certificates and all those things, I think we can rewrite what the corporate environment is going to look like in the years to come.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. You know, it's interesting. So there's like two sides of it, right? So trust your people. But then, you know, if you look at Chris, so I'm not sure if I get his name right, but Tyrone, he's asking in the little chat window, in your opinion, what has happened to corporate innovation spending? So it's almost like a trust in reverse. You know, okay, we're trusting them, but, you know, in the next 1 to 4 years, how's the spending look? You know, can they trust in the corporations to keep, you know, things going from a business perspective in a healthy way? You know, you want to touch on that a little bit, you know, Randy?
So I think there's two halves to the question. I don't think innovation spending is going to change over the next 3 years. I think it's still going to be good. I think we're in a transition period of how people manage their businesses, how they pay for things, how they do. Everything's changing. So during this change, there's a little bit of a pause. Mm-hmm. Although there's a lot of spending still happening, there's a little bit of a pause. And I think by no later the end of this year, things will pick back up. And you'll see the same kind of spending over the 3-year period. It just won't be as much in that first year as there will be in the second and third year. We're looking at things all the time. We have not changed our pathways or our patterns. If there's something for us to spend on today, we spend on it. But if there's nothing there, or if we're distracted by rebuilding certain parts of our business because of the change, then we end up with a little bit of a delay before some of the spending. But I think there's going to be good corporate spending.
That's interesting. Leslie, what are your thoughts in there? You know, you're with your business, you know, you're working with lots of different types of customers. What are you seeing?
Yeah, I agree with Randy. I think we're seeing the spending and the focus shifting to that gap filling that I was mentioning before. And I think one of the worst things that a company could do would be to, because that is a different, that is, it's innovation. It's a different kind of innovation, but it's still innovation because it's changing the way that things are happening. And I do see some companies actually letting people go in the innovation department because they're focusing on this gap filling activity. I think that's a mistake because, you know, as soon as those gaps are filled and you do have the workforce at home with everything that they need, then you're going to need need to shift back to innovation because, you know, the treadmill doesn't stop. It might get pointed in a slightly different direction that we didn't expect, but, you know, advancement and innovation never go away. You know, so if you're thinking about letting go of your innovation, people, don't do it. Don't do it. You're going to need them. There is actually one moment in Halt and Catch Fire where they make a decision to put everything on just the technical stuff. We got to get this thing out the door. And they cut out everything creative. And then the very next day, they're like, okay, we launched it. What do we build next? I don't know. All the creative people just quit because we crushed their dreams. You know, so you've got to keep the creativity going because there's always a tomorrow.
Yeah, I think to talk to Randy, I think, you know, we do have to be patient because pause is not necessarily the worst thing. It's okay to recalculate, you know, reboot. I think the biggest thing is maintain the communication so that there's still positive traction, you know, and I think it probably comes back to a little bit of everybody saying is communication, you know, and I think, you know, one of the things we noticed during the stay at home, at least when we were at home, is we upped the communication. You know, there are more kind of check-ins of how are you doing, you know? And I think that that's something that can be valued, you know? Ron, what do you think about some of these things that we're sharing?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. It's a couple of things, right? I mean, we look at two big buckets of investment, if you will, just from an innovation perspective. There's many, but two that I want to kind of put on the table just for discussion is the monies that we invest in R&D. So for a company like ours, for us, it's about 3% of sales on an average every year. Hey, we just announced our second quarter earnings just this morning. Our sales in second quarter is down 30%, as it is for most corporations in the world, right? But that doesn't mean our investment is also going down proportionally and saying, oh, by the way, now it's going to be lessened so that we're maintaining the ratio. Actually, we are trying to hold the ratio of 3% of the original sales of, you know, $20 billion on an annual basis for us. So there's some good things happening in terms of R&D investments, which is really trying to drive that primary organic growth through technological innovations, right? And there are many forms of innovation, right? There's HR, there's supply chain, there's many. I'm focusing on just the technological innovation. But the other piece, what we're looking at is also the CapEx that we spend. The capital expenditure we spend on a given year is also 3% of sales. So in a time like this, what we're trying to really do is tighten our belt on the capital expenditure. It's obvious because there's a lot of uncertainties. We don't know what to invest in, what factories invest in, what to upgrade or not. So we're trying to manage the CapEx in a clever way, and we're still trying to maintain the investments in organic growth, primarily through technological innovation, the core R&D. We're trying to keep it and preserve as much as possible. And I think that's where the prioritization of what not to do is the bigger conversation and a debate, and also healthy, so that we can place our bets in the right way. So these are some of the kind of dynamics that's getting played out, you know, in a company like ours, and I'm sure it's getting played out in all of your companies as well.
Mm-hmm. You know, as another question that we had kind of thought of here, you know, maybe a bit of a twist on something we've previously said. You know, what traps or pitfalls should we be avoiding? You know, we're talking about things that we could have been prepared, but, you know, what areas should we be avoiding? You know, Randy, you know, what are your thoughts there?
So I really think companies, people get it, they get too caught up in some short-term things. For example, you know, I've had people email me within the company say, why aren't we selling masks? Why aren't we building ventilators? Why aren't we doing this? And I understand the desire to do these short-term things, but what is our core? What are we good at? What can we succeed in? Those probably aren't them. So I've been pushing us to do more with the telemedicine, helping whether it's our program or somebody else's program, try to stay more adjacent and more long-term. So it's not just a short-term win because you either get great praise for doing it or you make a lot of money for doing it. I look at what are we really good at and how can I keep that going so that we end up in a great place and our customers, the whole society ends up in a great place. So I think some of the pitfalls are don't just look at that short-term opportunity. What is out there longer? You know, we talked about, Leslie actually talked about it, you know, getting something out the door and then what do you make next? You know, we got to be thinking about all that stuff all the time. Occasionally you do a short-term thing, but it can't be what you fall into and get trapped in.
Yeah, it's interesting. There's that term fear of missing out, you know, and, you know, you don't have to make masks too. You know, there's a lot of people doing it.
Yes.
And, you know, to even Leslie, you're saying that, you know, you're so excited about 5G, but you need the foundation of connectivity. And let's be honest, the whole world is not connected. And there's lots of gaps. And, you know, I've never seen any telecommunications company map where it's like solid, you know?
right. Yeah. And that's the thing that everybody's getting kind of caught up on now. It's like, oops.
I can't wait for the day where it's like, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
It's continuing that idea though of traps. I think another thing to watch out for is getting caught up in technical things and technology for technology's sake, rather than focusing on the solution. I think now more than ever we need to be focusing on what is the thing that we're doing. What is it actually accomplishing, and not go down a path even though it looks like the latest greatest thing until you can actually see clear benefit for your customers and or your employees. Ram, I really like that you actually brought that into it. Yeah, and there's, you know, and believe me, in the area that I am, I see a lot of technology for technology's sake. It's like, oh, we're doing this because it's the next big thing. It's like, well, what is it actually accomplishing? So until you've got a clear idea of that, yeah, don't waste your time with it.
And it's interesting, you talk about tech, and, you know, we're all like beta testers here, you know, but there's a lot of devices that are very power hungry. But then you have something like the Kindle, where the battery lasts forever, you know, so yeah, it might not have the same types of you know, effects as a real high definition screen, but then what are you trying to do? You know, and I think we got to look at, do you even need tech at all? You know, is paper good enough? Sometimes that's pretty good, you know, believe it or not.
Butter.
You know, that's excellent. You know, I think, you know, so another question came up here about government grants. You know, I'm kind of curious about what you three have to say. You know, there are certain corporations that really like to focus on government grants. And it's neat to see how much federal and state level help is happening today. You know, should government bodies be more aggressive, you know, with corporate funding and spending down? Should they double down? You know, where is that? Where's the place? You know, maybe Ron, would you like to share a little bit?
Yeah, I'll be more than glad to take that one. Absolutely. I mean, if you really look at our core research activities around energy, the DOE, the Department of Energy, the Department of Defense, and quite a few of the local governments and state governments, even at the municipality level, are really have some very long-term plans around looking at energy and everything I talked about, sustainability and efficiency and all of those things, which is core to what we do. And there is money available even now, even today, there is money available. So I would absolutely, and by the way, in the core R&D, we call it OPM, other people's money, so the government OPM. It's a good thing. It funds about a third of our research activities within my research labs. And so we are very active even today to stay in touch with the right decision makers within not only the national labs like NREL and Lawrence Livermore, but also the Department of Energy and the Department of Defense. And I would encourage people to kind of really think about the right proposals and really understand where the governments are going, whether it's US or Europe or other parts of the world. There is still a lot of activity going on. And that's an area that continues to be a very key source of funding for research activities overall. And it's still an active area, Bill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Randy, does your, you know, you're an interesting, you know, being kind of a U.S. and Japanese, you know, how does your company engage, or do they engage in government grants?
So we haven't engaged in the government giving us money to do research, because that core research for us is mostly done in Japan. It's all funded by the corporation. What we do participate in, though, is government grants that are given to hospitals or to medical centers or to physicians to research and or to help people. So we've been really focused on trying to help those grants that are getting whether it's equipment or treatment or just healthcare professionals into underserved areas of the United States. You know, in Chicago, you can, you know, drive 10 miles and from one spot to the next, the age that the people there will live to is about 20 years difference. It's in the 50s in one area, it's in the 70s in the other area. Mm-hmm. And that's because they don't have healthcare. So we've been trying to work with government grants. They're mostly state. There are some federal that come out. And then also grants that aren't government, but from organizations like the American Heart Association or the American Diabetes Association to get care to those patients that need it. And in our world, it's, you know, we might contribute blood pressure monitors, or we might sell mm-hmm. blood pressure monitors at cost so that the nurses that go in there can take people's blood pressure. They find someone that's hypertensive, they give them a monitor and say, use this, monitor yourself. And if you're in trouble, call us back. So it's, you know, it's just a different way of using the money. But for us, it's more about getting the care to the patient, getting new therapies designed than doing our basic research.
Yeah, I'd like to switch it up a little bit here. Let's look ahead in 2021. It's kind of amazing to think that we're actually starting to plan. How does business look? You know, what do you think it's going to be like? Can you tell the future? Ram, you got some thoughts?
Oh, goodness gracious. We were just talking about that in our earnings call and what the outlook is going to be and the recovery over the next 12, 24, 36 months. I think a third of the offices are still going to be empty. And again, there's an important piece to what I'm trying to say here. I think one is working from home is going to take on a whole different meaning. So everything we've talked about in terms of employees, people, trusting, leveraging what the new skills is, all of that, well, I think just takes on a whole different meaning over the next 12, 24, 36 months. It's not a 2021 thing. From what I'm seeing in my crystal ball, Bill, right? That's one thing. The second thing is, at least, I mean, look at us. All we need is a laptop and a home desk to do our job and do it pretty effectively. Out of my 10,000 engineers, wherever I've been in the world, in Europe or Asia or the US, I've only had about a few engineers around me. What I'm trying to say is a lot of the conversations and all the discussions happens in a forum like this, and it's been happening for the last 5-10 years pre-COVID, right? Mm-hmm. And so there's a whole demographic that's interesting. Like people like us, we can do with a laptop and a nice good connection, an IT connection. But I think we also need to look at the next years to come. How are we going to keep our critical resources? And I'm going to speak from an engineering technology perspective, where a laptop is not sufficient for them. They need more powerful computers to do whatever they do in terms of, you know, heavy duty engineering, technology, modeling, simulation, and all those things. How do we make sure that they get the right tools for the trade so that they are equally effective, they're productive, and they're, you know, having a nice, fulfilling career, et cetera, which is very different than ours at the stage we are in right now. I think some of the dynamics are going to be very interesting. And just think about it, Bill, a third of office spaces, our headquarters here in Cleveland, okay, is still going to be empty. And I'm taking third as a conservative. Now, how do you utilize and how do you keep this? There's a whole different of economics that I think we need to start to think about, at least the next 12 months, maybe longer than that.
I love what you said there, because I tell you what, last year it was like a battle for a conference room. It's not a battle anymore. You know, we're repurposing them and it's awesome. It's like newfound space, you know, I was interesting. You know, Randy, I'd like to ask your thoughts on this, and then I got a question for Leslie.
I agree with what Ram said. The other thing that I think will be different, there'll be less travel. In the past, you were going to go see a customer, even for a 1-hour visit, you jumped on a plane, you spent money on a hotel, you rented a car, all that for 1 hour. I think we've learned through this whole pandemic that, hey, maybe that video conference isn't so bad. And I can do 3 of them in a day versus 1. I think the efficiency of work will be better. And I think less travel. I mean, CTAs canceling the CES meeting. I think big conventions are going to be, even in 2021, a challenge at best. And people are finding that doing this virtually isn't so bad. I mean, yeah, we all get Zoom fatigue, but it's still not that bad. If you're tired at the end of the day, you walk in the other room to your bed, not go to a hotel and try to get comfortable. Your day's over. So I think there's a big win for employees and a big win for companies there.
I totally agree. So, you know, I have to ask this now, Leslie, your future thinking, let's look ahead 10 years from now. Okay. 2030, what's different? What's the same?
Well, I completely agree with what Ram and Randy just said. I think a lot of the changes that are happening that we're seeing are going to be one-way changes. Things like I don't know, in some places in Europe, you see public water fountains that have a tin cup chained to them that were things that, you know, in the past, it was a common cup that everybody would use to drink out of when they came to that fountain. And we don't do that anymore. And you look at that, you go, oh my God, were they crazy? And I think a lot of the practices that we've had are going to, you know, 5-10 years from now, we're never going to do that again. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, so things like, you know, mentioning meeting rooms being empty and stuff. Well, at Nokia, they've taken out 75% of the offices of ours that are open. I have taken out 75% of the chairs so that a 12-person conference room can only seat 3 people so that everybody can be distanced. I think things like that are going to, I don't know if it's still going to be in place in 10 years, but I think at least for the next 2 or 3, for sure. But for the really, really different things, we are going to be seeing one of the things that's most important about the COVID moment is the drive towards digitization that's happening. And, you know, to replace travel, to replace things that put people at risk because they need to be face-to-face with people. There's Japanese companies that are creating now robots to do the stocking on shelves to replace people, not because they want to drive people out of the workforce, but they want to reduce the number of people that need to be exposed to things that are situations that are dangerous now. And so digitization in many, many forms and computerization and automation of things, the rise of many sensors and the hooking together of the sensors to be able to gather the data and make it meaningful. The kinds of things that Randy was talking about earlier, you know, wearing your own blood pressure measurement thing and then your blood pressure is sent to your doctor and then your doctor responds. Even more of that, having that being an automated process where it's an automated thing that's looking at it and then flags it up if something's bad. Just tying systems and information closer and closer and closer together. And the thing that's really going to change is going back to the mixed reality thing that I was talking about. We're going to be actually moving away from these devices like the phones and even possibly laptops and moving much more.
I call this
towards
the adult teddy bear.
Yeah.
Where is it?
Exactly. Oh my God. Yes. And your teddy bear is going to be, it's going to be much more integrated with your environment.
Yeah.
And so, and your voice and your gesture and also your, you know, if you wear glasses, you're in really good shape because the kind of the interface to have something on your head that you speak to that actually gives you lots of information. And you know, yes, these are all the things that are being developed now and 10 years from now. The way that we interface with computers in particular is going to be completely different than today.
You know, I always like to say, when I think of the future, I imagine myself saying, I cannot believe, or my kids saying, I can't believe you had to do that. You know, how right. could you have done that? You know, that's crazy, you know? So Ram, you know, you're always looking at kind of the global setting of things, which is I've always found fascinating. What do you think about 10 years from now, and you know, maybe even beyond the US, you know?
Yeah, no, we certainly, you know, look at a global picture, Bill. I mean, it's very interesting. The dynamics are different, right? I mean, people talk about Europe. Well, it's not Europe. Every country in Europe is different. Germany is different. You know, Italy is different. France, all of them are different, right? US has got some similar dynamics that gets played out. And Asia, it's whole different complex ecosystem. So if, when we look at this big picture and look at some of the secular trends, look at some of the mega trends that's impacting the way we live, work, and play, there are a few things that come up. You know, one is what Randy kind of made some comments in his opening kind of remarks. The nature of healthcare is fundamentally going to change. And a thing like COVID-19 is just accelerating it. Randy, if there's one more point in terms of funding in the US, Randy, go after there is funding for telehealth, digital. I don't need to tell you this, so you probably know this, but the government is putting a lot of money in anything, startups, ideas, innovations around, you know, NIST and NIH, and you know that stuff. So there's going to be this increase in telehealth, digital healthcare in general. And it echoes what Leslie was talking about. With whole emphasis on digitalization, connectivity, security, cybersecurity. Randy, this is your world. HIPAA compliance is your world. And all of those things is just going to take on a whole different meaning, which also means there are a lot of naughty guys out there who are going to try to hack these things.
Yep.
They're going to hack these things. So there's a whole different angle on that.
There's a flip side, isn't there?
Yes,
exactly.
Security for sure.
It's a double-edged sword, right? The same thing gets...
Look at this. Wonderful.
Same thing... Sorry, Bill, go ahead.
Sorry, I just noticed a little four-legged friend. Sorry.
Exactly, exactly.
All right.
The same dynamics gets played around in the world we live in. Energy. So when you're talking about planes, trains, automobiles, energy, there's a fundamental shift in the way the world is going to generate electrons, store it, use it. Everything's going to change. And this whole movement around sustainability and the more electric, you know, cars and planes and trains, this is fundamentally happening. And there are a lot of underlying technologies that need to propel these things in a different way rather than today's world of internal combustion engines and this and that fundamentally changes. So if you're a technologist, you want to really look and pay attention to what are these trends that's happening around electricity to make it safe, reliable, sustainable, and efficient. So there's a big change in this whole electrification that's happening throughout the world. Throughout the world, okay? The value proposition just changes when you're talking about, you know, Johannesburg, South Africa, Shanghai, China, Pune, India, or any city in Europe or US. The fundamental thing is the same, the value prop changes. And the third big thing I really think is going to fundamentally shift is education. It's fundamentally going to shift. It's fundamentally going to shift in how students are going to consume education, the mechanism, the means, and it's happening right now. You know, if you have kids, whether school going or college going kids, it's happening right now, starting this fall semester, what's happening in the dynamics. And I think that's just going to get amplified. And I think it's going to change and put some pressure on the education system by the universities when they're going to get some nice, good, healthy competition from the likes of Coursera and Udacity and Udemy and all of those people.
I love that you said that. There's a Q&A question where they said, do you think corporations and businesses will value formalized education less due to the rise of micro degrees?
I'll give you my perspective. It's important. I call it the macro or the mega degrees, right? The bachelor's, master's, and PhDs. And now there is this whole slew of micro degrees or these certificate courses. I value the micro degrees, which shows a very critical skill of an individual, which is the learning agility. And it doesn't matter whether you're 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, or whatever it is, you still have that agility to learn, retool, unlearn, learn, unlearn. It's an important trait. And I think corporations, if they don't value that, they're missing out. They will not be around because the good employees, the good folks will not be in those companies anymore. So I think these micro degrees, the certificate courses will fundamentally, I think, is very critical. And corporations will value it. And that was my opening comment to say that a lot of these things happening right now, just engage our staff in being able to tap that when they actually show and come back to you, boss, I got this little PMP certificate over the COVID holidays. I'm going to make you a program manager, Joe. That's what's new.
That's cool. You know, Randy, I we've been talking a lot about lots of different country perspectives, and you bring this perspective from Japan. What's happening over there as far as education and how it interacts with corporate? Is there something different, or are they pretty much on the same page as what we're going through? Or can you shine some light?
I would say they're a few years behind us. These, you know, micro degrees, as we're calling them, or training program, whatever you want to call them, they're not as as prevalent in Japan as they are here, nowhere near. It's still more of the formal education there. It's going to change. It just hasn't changed yet. So they're trailing behind us a while. Here, there's much more opportunity. And as Ram just mentioned, in this COVID period, or any period going forward where people are working from home, if we just gave them back another hour from commuting, there's an hour they can spend learning about something. Whatever it is, it could be for themselves, it could be for the company, but they got time now that they didn't have before.
Yeah, it's interesting. I'll throw a little thing that I did. I don't know if anybody knows this, but Harvard is offering free classes. And you know what? I signed up. I signed up for a class on the edX platform. I'm not sure if anybody's heard of that, but it's pretty interesting. And who doesn't want a little micro degree from Harvard? I will definitely show that around the office. And I'll print it out. I'm going to print
it. There you go, Bill.
But Bill, you actually asked a really important question about that unity between educational institutions and industry. And, you know, because Nokia is headquartered in Finland they have an amazing interlock between all the different kinds of industry and the government and the education there. And it's really spectacular. So they really are always training up the engineers that they need for all of the different industries. And, you know, because Finland is a country with almost no natural resources except for trees. And so they really firmly understand that their natural resource is the brains of the people who are there. And so that's been a real eye-opener for me to be exposed to that aspect of Finland. And that's something, and so companies working together with both large institutions and with the smaller degree programs that we're talking about here as well, that's actually a way to really, you know, if you're saying companies that say, you know, I can't find the engineers I need, or I can't find the female engineers that I need, or I can't find the people of color that I need, that's when you really need to be partnering with not just universities, but these diversity, these certificate programs, and create them, build them, help it happen, make it happen. Just sitting back and like, oh, can't really see anybody out there. No, that's not good enough.
I love where this is going. And I think, you know, as we're kind of wrapping up here, would you believe it? We only have 2 minutes left. This has been great. I just want to say thanks to everybody. We have one final question I want to ask the panelists. You know, you've received great advice, I'm sure. What advice has made such a big impact on you, and what can you share with others? How about we'll go with Ram.
Okay. Well, the best advice I've gotten actually is from my mother. When I was a teenager, and that's been my North Star throughout my life. And it's actually said in my mother tongue, Tamil, which is very powerful when you say it in Tamil, but crudely translated in English, what it translates down to is, once you put your foot forward, don't take it back.
Yeah, just go big or go home, right?
Just keep going. Yeah, so
keep going.
My mom.
Appreciate
smart
that.
Smart lady.
Randy, what are your thoughts there? Any sage advice you could share?
Well, the best advice I ever got was, if you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room. Surround yourself with great people. Don't try to be the smartest person in the room or in the Zoom call.
In the Zoom.
You want smarter people there, because that's how you win. So.
That's wonderful advice. And last but not least, Leslie.
The best advice I've ever gotten came from a baby book when I was expecting my first child, and it's start as you mean to continue. So always have the long game in play. Short-term measures, half measures, don't waste your time with them. Always have the long game in your mind.
You know, I love that you said that. In our second episode here, we had Mark Fleming from Vitamix talk about how some of the best advice he's gotten is from parenting books. And it's kind of interesting when you break it down to the simple common denominator, and, you know, relying on that. And that's, you know, as I sum it up here, I think that, you know, the road ahead could be pretty neat. You know, I think that, you know, the nice thing, one of the silver linings I've seen is we've kind of reconnected with the human side of things, even though we're kind of virtual. You know, it's pretty exciting. So I just want to say thank you to everybody here for joining us, all the questions and answer, you know, questions and, you know, the three speakers. You know, I just want to say that this has been a lot of fun. Personally, I, you know, thank you so much.
It's been great.
So let's give them a virtual round of applause, and I'm going to go out with this little video.